Well, under Coach Lisa Fortier, the Zags are going to run out this same lineup they've been running basically literally all year.
Yeah, and it's a great veteran lineup for them. They know what they're doing, and they've played together for a really long time. So their chemistry is on point. They start the Zags out every game and have done well so far.
As for San Diego, Veronica Sheffy is the one to watch. She's leading their team in scoring with 12 points a game. Also, Harsimran Kaur, who will be in to tip for the Toreros, 23 blocks. That's second in the WCC. She can really get up there.
Yeah, Kaur has a lot of length to her, a lot of size. Look to her to be aggressive with these Gonzaga posts. USD has a tough assignment for them today, but if they're able to get it done, they will hand Gonzaga their first WCC loss.
So Kaur will be in to tip for San Diego. She's 6'4" against the 6'1" Yvonne Ejim.
That just shows you that this team has so many capable scorers.
No doubt about it. Zags out to an early 5-2 lead, and here's Kaylee Trong over on the wing. Fascinating. Last year, Kaylee ran point for this team, but it's really been Kaylin who has been running the one so far. Feed down low to Eliza Hollingsworth. It's around and off, and Kaur with a great rebound. Like we said, she can go up and get it.
Great look for her. She just missed it. Sometimes that happens, but I like that they're trying to get her going early as well.
This is Veronica Sheffy out top for the Toreros, 12 points a game. Back to Jess Finney. This is the University of Washington transfer, and she's up for a J. It won't go down. And you can already see Yvonne Ejim and Harsimran Kaur, they're banging down in the post. This is going to be a matchup to watch today.
They're battling. See here Kaylee Trong in that pick and roll. That's such a tough matchup with Kaylee Trong with the ball in her hands, Yvonne Ejim setting that screen, because who do you stop? They're both capable scoring in a multitude of ways in that pick and roll. Just does a great job of keeping her dribble, keeping her defender on her backside, and finishing at the rim.
Well, Shaq, you're so right. And your question actually goes.
Bit of a collision there.
Yeah, Brennan Maxwell ends up on the floor. I have to imagine they're going to give her a block there. We're waiting on the official call from the refs. It'll be the block on Maxwell and two shots. And that'll take us down into our first break of the afternoon. San Diego hitting some shots and playing tough defense and holding.
The courage to reach for the stars. But imagine how much easier it will be to raise your hand with the confidence of a Gonzaga degree.
Well, the Bulldogs have made their last three shots. One of those was from Kaylee Trong, Shaq, who had a big milestone here on Thursday night against Santa Clara as part of that win. Topped 1,000 career points.
That was such a great moment for her because she's battled through some injuries in her career.
Yep.
When she came back from the said injuries, she was trying to get into her flow. I think that messed with her confidence a little bit. She wasn't knocking down shots. So to see her just work and grind and have such a tough mentality to fight through all that adversity and have that milestone.
Kaylee Trong heads to the bench for the Zags. She'll be replaced by Callie Stokes. And Mott Hypens will play some forward as
down on the baseline. Fun fact, though, her teammate, Kaylin Trong, gave her the nickname PJ Tucker, because she reminds Kaylin of how PJ, just his toughness, his commitment on the defensive end.
Sure.
Not sure if Callie's shoe game is as legendary as PJ Tucker, but that's what she brings to this team, just toughness, a commitment on the defensive end of the floor, and now she's starting to bring that offensive mindset to her game as well.
Definitely one of the players of the future of this program. And here goes Maxwell. Brenna's already got 5 points. Zags will run this one down inside, 10 to go on the shot clock. Here goes Vani Ejim. Man, she does not need that much space. But Casey Neubert with the rebound, and that is not the last time that we are going to say that today. Casey Neubert is averaging a double-double this year. She's had 6 in one season, Shaq.
She does such a great job on the boards, and just her commitment to go to the offensive and defensive rebounds every single possession. She's just relentless on the board, so that's also a defensive assignment that these Zags have to key on.
Anytime you see number 22, that is the one to keep your eye on. Zags go to the bench, and out comes Bree Salenbein. Zags will make some big substitutions here, and boy, how much fun has it been to see Bree finally get healthy and get our first, you know, real look at her of about five or six games as a Zag.
Yeah, she's starting to get her win, starting to pick up that confidence of those in-game reps. She's another player for the future for this Zags program.
I think they're going to count that one. They did. We'll send Sheffy back on and take the freshman point guard Lauren McCall off. And here comes Kaylee Trong. Here, so if you're watching this game at home this afternoon, you might want to come out before the end of the year and pay your respects to those two.
Yeah, they've been a staple in this Gonzaga program for so long now and chose to come back for that extra year after. I think it's fair to say that nobody was necessarily happy with how their season ended last year. So for everybody to kind of buy in and come back for another year, and they're taking care of business so far this season.
Rejected, Mott Hybens. Wow. Smacked away from Casey Newbert, who scores 11 points a game and is their leading rebounder. That's the impressive one to do it against. San Diego will try it again. Five to shoot, and it's Carr out top. One to go. Got to get rid of it. Too late. Zag ball.
San Diego runs a lot of different actions, lots of different ball movement. You see Mount here just staying nice and tall, using her length, not swinging down, which posts have a tendency to do. Just use her length there, just got enough of those fingertips on the ball to affect that shot. And then what ended up leading to a shot clock violation.
A lot of teams we have seen here in the kennel this year be very comfortable winding it down inside 10 or even 5 seconds on the clock against this team.
Definitely trying to make the Zags work on the defensive end of the floor.
To Kylie Horsemeyer, that has been their best play of the afternoon.
And that's what they want to do. That they want to get their points in transition, running hard. Against this Zag team, it can be a little bit tough because that's the pace they want to play as well. So it's which team can run hard in transition but keep it under control.
Here's Eliza Hollingsworth. Beat Newbert to the rim, and she'll get two at the line. This was a heck of a play.
Yeah, did a great job of getting in the passing lane, starting the break, great job running the lane. Little bounce pass leading her to the basket, finishing through traffic. This is what the Toreros want to do. That's been a signature for them for years.
Good or bad for Gonzaga if San Diego is comfortable playing as fast as the Zags do in transition?
I think bad, because I don't think you want to play at that pace every single time. Because they're also bringing pressure defensively after they score. They're going to press you full court, whether they score, make, miss, whatever. So it can be pretty exhausting, and you don't want to get into the second half where you start having those mental errors trying to play at that pace for way too long. So they need to settle. Zags are bringing some pressure of their own here, which I like to see.
Stokes on Finney. One of the similar things between these two offenses is how much they like to keep the forwards on the perimeter. Harsimran Carr very comfortable working out there. This should be on GU. Just knocked out of bounds. No foul on the play. We'll go again. About 90 seconds remaining in this first quarter. Back-to-back games this weekend where the visiting team has hung around. Three to shoot. Sheffy. No. Out of bounds, Zag ball. Opposing teams come in jacked up and ready to go.
Yeah, this is a fun environment for a lot of teams to come in and play in front of. There's been a couple of times where a team comes in and knocks the Zags off on their home court because they are just so excited to play. Everybody plays their best when they come into an environment like this, I'd like to think. So the Zags just have to keep pushing. I know it's only a 5-point margin right here, but it's a long game. Stick to your scouting report. Stick to the game plan.
Ejim fouled aggressively. And Vonnie will go to the line. Just one quick note, if you haven't really followed this Gonzaga team this year, yes, there have been some times like Thursday when the opponents will come in and have it be basically a tie game at the end of the first quarter, but what inevitably has ended up happening the last couple of years is when that happens, it doesn't matter. Zags still end up winning by 25 points.
Yeah, they do a good job of just sticking to their game plan. It's a long game, four quarters of play.
And Esther Little comes on for Bree Salenbein as Vonnie misses her first.
Just like we expected, Ejim and Carr are kind of going at it. I think that was a little bit of a frustration foul on Carr because down at the other end she was working. Mates missed her a few times. Vonnie's able to convert there. So we'll have to see how the foul count, being aggressive.
Well, what a takeaway by Kaylee Truong. Avoids the foul. Esther Little will follow. Sheffy's got her tied up. And this is San Diego ball. I think it looked like Kaylee didn't really know where the defender was behind her. We'll see here. And she didn't know whether to go up and how to do it and kind of misplayed it.
Yeah, I think she was trying to make sure that she kept it on her right shoulder. By
the geometry angle of that pass, almost impossible.
Just such a great job of getting 2 feet in the paint and being patient. Again, there's a lot of trust between those two. They've played together for a long time now. They know each other's tendencies. There's a lot of fun basketball being played here. You see here, waits. Good little bounce pass. Bonnie knows to go and get it and finishes with a little bit of traffic too.
And if you're playing one-on-one defense on Vonnie there, how do you stop that? San Diego has gone ice cold, one of their last seven from the field here coming up on the end of the first quarter. And I believe it was like 15-13 at one point. So this has been quite the little run for the Bulldogs.
Doing a great job of taking care of the ball, valuing each possession, not turning it over, getting great shots every time down the floor, and also getting stops defensively. So if you're the Toreros, you got to find ways to get the ball into the paint. I think they've missed Carr a couple times on her duck-ins. She's looking for that high-low pass. So you have to handle some pressure on the perimeter and get the ball into the paint where you can get some easy baskets.
All right, 29 seconds on the game clock. There were 28 on the shot clock as the ball was inbounded. So San Diego can either truly hold for the last shot or the Zags will have one more chance. Carr tips it out. This will stay with the Toreros. No more shot clock. 17.3, and that's it. This will be Sheffy to inbound. And it is with a hair over a second left. 1.2.
I thought there was quite a bit of contact there on Kaylin Truong's drive, but kudos to Carr for just stepping over 2 feet outside the paint and not fouling.
Vonnie Ejim. Well drawn up play, no contact, no foul. That was a pretty eventful, explosive first quarter. 10 minutes gone. Zags winning. Gonzaga team so hard to guard on defense. San Diego was keeping pace until about 2.5, maybe even 3 minutes left to go in the first quarter. And then the Gonzaga offense turned it on. We're through 10 minutes of basketball. 21-13 Gonzaga. This team, Shaniqua Nillis, they're the best shooting team in the WCC. The team shoots an unheard of 49% from the field as a collective. They're also scoring over 80 points a game, and they shoot 40% from three. How do you guard this group? Where do you even start?
It's so tough, because like you said, with all those facts and figures, it's efficiency. They don't make a lot of mistakes, and they're putting the ball in the basket. So I think the best way to start, or the best place to start, is with a lot of ball pressure. You have to make it tough on them, and you have to be physical. So I think that's in the Toreros' game plan as well. However, the Zags are starting to become used to that scouting report against themselves. So it's tough. I'm glad I'm not an opposing coach, because I really don't know who you shut down on any given night. Even if you choose a player, then you have four more that are ready to step up and fill that void.
Yeah, not fun when you have five players on the Zags averaging over 10 points a game, and then they can still go to Bree Salenbein or anybody else off the bench. Kylie Horsemeyer out top, she and now Casey Neubert had very good first quarters. Here's our Simran Carr to the rim, no. Neubert underneath, and she'll let.
That's a design backdoor play. I think that's a coach's call as well, where you're running it after a timeout or after a quarter break. You have Kaylin coming up. She's acting like she's going to do a dribble handoff, and then she ball fakes. Her sister goes back door. Wasn't able to finish there, but she does get herself to the free throw line, able to knock down that first free throw. But that's exactly what we're talking about. They're so efficient. They have their sets. Even when they're not running sets, they just have scores. So it's very difficult to shut this Gonzaga team down. The Toreros have had some good looks offensively as well. They're just not finishing. I think some of that has to do with the size, the length, this pressure that the GU team is bringing in as well. But they have to find ways to score.
behind the back from the Washington transfer, Jess Finney.
You see Kaylin able to get to the basket like so.
All right, Shaq, that last 30 seconds, and I want you to break this down for the folks at home, it's such a good example of what is up with this Gonzaga team this year. They allow the second best shooting percentage of any team in the conference. Other teams shoot well against the Zags, but the Zags turn around, they go in transition, they go so fast, and then they score. That's the thing about this team. Teams are shooting 43% against them, but then the Zags are just the best shooting team, and that has not bit them yet.
Yeah, they're doing a great job of just finding ways to get the ball in the basket. Defensively, they have to be a little bit better, a little bit more disciplined.
Brenna Maxwell goes to the bench. One too many early fouls on her second. And Mott Heibels will come back on. Well, if you're San Diego and you're hoping to stay in this game, getting Brenna Maxwell to the bench, who usually hits, I don't know, 4 or 5 threes a game sometimes it feels like, that's a good place to start, getting rid of the three-point shot, right?
Yeah, that's a great scouting report to be physical with her. She picked up that offensive foul, so that sends her to the bench.
Kaylin Trong the rebound. Malia Tharp came on that last dead ball for San Diego. And what a story of Kaylin Trong. Last couple years, with the exception of a couple games of injuries from her sister, I mean, Kaylin Trong, Shaq, was the shooting guard. And all of a sudden, here she is this year with, what is it? She's eighth in the country in total assists.
Yeah, her and her sister are pretty interchangeable. They kind of played off of each other really well in high school and able to come to GU together and do the same thing. So even though one was doing something a little bit more or better last season, they're both really capable.
Yep.
I'm loving what I'm seeing from Yvonne Ejim, though. Just the play before that, she was able to pick up a foul. They ran a little play where she gets it at the high post, able to catch, rip, drive through some traffic, get a foul call, and then go right at her again out of the out-of-bounds play, a little duck in, makes a little move. She's so strong. When she has 2 feet in the paint like that, she's very, very hard to stop.
Misses her first. Vani has 7 points already on 3-for-4 shooting with 2 boards. She had 12 last time she played San Diego. She's already got 8, and we're not anywhere near halftime yet. So if she keeps this up, she'll be closer to 20 today.
It's scary how effective she is. You'll see her numbers, and it's crazy to think the numbers that she puts up, like you're saying, before even halftime.
Back to the Zags. Well, Casey Neubert has been all over the ball today, given that the Zags have kind of quieted Veronica Sheffy, who's their leading scorer. And Neubert only has 2 points, but, I mean, she's all over the ball. Give her that. Ejim. No.
Yeah, she's working hard. She's getting out running here in transition. She crashes the boards hard. Definitely a utility player for this San Diego program.
Tipped away by Callie Stokes.
That's what Callie is in to do. Get some deflections.
What a beautiful play. Ejim tries to get fouled. Second chance, no. Looking for the ball for a third chance. Yes, it's Heibens. Zags could have reset that one. Instead, they give it up. Aggressive, though. Fun to see. This team is so fun to watch.
Refs are letting them play a little bit, I would say. There's some body, some lower contact happening on both ends of the floor. It'll be interesting to see how the teams deal with this physicality of play, how they adjust.
And the foul is Dylan Horton was getting started driving. That'll be on Esther Little. Only the second foul of the half on Gonzaga. 3 on San Diego. You are right, Shaq. They are not whistling a lot. Ejimon Finney. Two of the best players on the floor. 5 to shoot. Horton for the jump shot, no. And Kaylin Trong the rebound. Horton shoots 40% from 3. Jump shots are kind of her game, even though that one didn't go.
Yeah, she needs to continue to look to be aggressive. Same with Finney. I feel like she's being a little bit timid here. Zach's doing a good job of guarding her, clogging up those driving lanes.
More contact down low as Casey Newbert hit the floor really hard, and I mean, everyone in this arena heard that too. She went down on her lower back.
It's a tough position that Newbert was put in. She had a couple of zags around in help side.
And they're keeping her on. I mean, simultaneously good for her, but also ouch, as Dylan Horton, the deuce and the damage.
And you see that aggressiveness here. Able to go in. Callie's crowding a little bit. She has a great job of creating that contact, absorbing it, and finishing at the rim.
That was the first basket of the game for Dylan Horton. And she turns it into a three-point play. The Zags, meanwhile, have started to go cold. They haven't made a bucket in about 3 minutes. They are 0 for their last six from the field.
Able to cut this to an 8-point lead from the Zags. 5 minutes to go in the second quarter.
Thought Callie Stokes might want to take that one. Instead, it's Liza. And Callie went flying through the air, going for the rebound. She'll get whistled for that one.
Stokes does a great job there of just crashing. I think she's a little disappointed with how stagnant and casual her team has become in this second half of the second quarter. In the first period, San Diego only scored 13, Gonzaga 21, but now in the second, they both have only scored 7, so GU has definitely cooled down, but I think they've gone away from what was making them successful, running their sets, being aggressive, valuing each possession. But kudos to this Toreros program for coming out in that second quarter and starting to be a little bit more aggressive. They're crashing the boards, they're making physical decisions on their ball screen defense as well. So
Kaylee Trong, instead it's out of bounds, and San Diego will take it back with an 8-point lead, 8-point deficit, rather. It's interesting, though. The Zags are 0 for 7, haven't scored in a couple of minutes, Shaq, and yet San Diego hasn't really closed the gap because their offense is just not scoring either.
I think the size, the length of...
Mott Hybens ended up on the floor. This will be Zag ball.
I thought that was a great possession for both programs, actually.
Yeah.
Toreros were moving the ball around. They got what they wanted. You know, Newbert making a play at the rim. She wasn't able to finish, but also the Zags were doing a great job of closing out, helping the helper. So both teams are battling on both ends of the floor, and that's why the score is reflecting that. Back up.
Refs starting to work those whistles a little bit more now the last few minutes after a pretty quiet start, and Coach Fortier on the bench really letting him hear it, actually. So here comes Sheffy, their leading scorer on the season. She has 6 points so far.
When she's aggressive to the rim and looking to score, that's when San Diego is at their best. She wants to get to rim, also has a nice pull-up, so she's able to score. I think it's just hard to do so against the Zags program, but did a great job there of drawing a foul and converting at the free throw line.
Well, she's been aggressive, but not efficient. She is 2 for 6 so far.
And by Kaylin Trong. Almost a turnover there, but Eliza was able to gobble that up and find her on the perimeter.
The Virginia Tech transfer, Maddie Vejcicki, on the floor now for San Diego. Number 14. And Kylie Horsemeyer back out there now to guard. Kaylee Trong on defense. She's been up in the Zags' faces on the defensive side of the ball. Salenbein tried to go for the contact. I think it was clean, and it was. So stay with GU with 16 on the shot clock. What do they need her to be by March?
Just aggressive, confident. She has to continue to keep those turnovers low because she's going to play a lot of that 1-2 position. She's going to.
Bree Salenbein, hello. A couple of big blocks for this Gonzaga team so far in the first half.
Undersized point guard, you have to learn how to score outside of your frame a lot, or else you are susceptible to getting blocked by the defensive team. So she has a great job of extending that left arm, finishing outside of her frame, kissing off the glass.
And that gets her to double digits. Kaylee, the first to 10 this afternoon for the Zags. Horsemeyer out top.
That's where she wants to go. So I wouldn't be surprised if there's some changes with how they guard Sheffy in a pick and roll action. You see here, screen, she's going to that dominant hand, 1-2 dribble pull up. That's part of her game that she's really confident in, so you have to take that away.
No, Kaylin Trong, her second. Callie Stokes back on the floor. And man, what a first half for Yvonne Ejim. Zags have now made their last four shots.
There was a big discussion about Ejim's, I wouldn't say inability to make the three, but she just doesn't shoot them very often, and how that was going to affect how people guard her. But she has just proven that if...
6.7 left on the game clock, so San Diego will have one last bite at the apple. San Diego Valley, 24 County Horsemeyer, first personal. 15, Yvonne Ejim will be at the line. Foul just in time with 0.3 on the clock. It'll be a foul on Esther Little. It's Kiki Osfiecki to the free throw line. Some last minute points trying to make it a 10-point game.
Great job by Sheffy of realizing 6.7 on the clock. She pushed it hard, able to get her teammate to the line. And like you said, if you can cut this to 10, you're in a pretty good spot going into half.
Certainly closer than Santa Clara had it here on Thursday. Fun first half of basketball. After 20, Gonzaga 43, the number 16 Bulldogs. San Diego hanging pretty tight compared to the rest of the West Coast Conference with 33. And here to talk about the first 20 minutes of basketball, let's talk to Gonzaga's head coach Lisa Fortier. Coach, your early thoughts on the first half here.
Well, they're being really physical, and for some reason they're getting all the calls, which is what happens. That's why we tell our team that they can't call them all, and it's frustrating, but we got to play stronger on offense, and we have to stop fouling them on the defensive side. Some of their points a lot of them have come from free throws, and we're not making ours, so that's my first thought.
Well, we'd love to hear other thoughts. You guys have done a good job today of bottling up Casey Neubert, one of their best players. She's averaging a double-double. How do you keep her bottled up in the last 20 minutes?
Yeah, Vonnie's a great defender. She's been the primary guard on her, but as we might need to go to switching or something, we haven't done a great job on Sheffy. So everyone has to just stay with an eye towards her, make her go to her right hand. You know, she's a very good player when she goes left, and she's just slightly less good, but not as good going to her right. So we got to do that. We got to keep her off the glass, and I think a lot of us need to do a better job on checking out, and just the theme of it is just play more physical in the second half.
All right, Coach, thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, 20 minutes down, 20 to go, with half on the bench with those two fouls.
That was definitely a position that Maxwell probably hasn't found herself in quite some time. She got two quick early fouls, found herself on the bench, and that changes how they push in transition, what they're trying to look at in transition. It changes the set calls that they can run out of timeouts or even just in their secondary transition opportunities. So kudos to the Zags as well of finding a way to get stuff done and have a 10-point lead at half with Maxwell on the bench. But I do think with her on the floor, it changes the dynamic of this team significantly.
All right, so the upcoming schedule for the Zags, first of all, you can catch all these games right here on ESPN+. Quick little road trip down to St. Mary's and then down to LMU, rather, and then back for the next home game, which is that always fun rivalry with St. Mary's. Then back on the road for quite a while here. Not a lot of home games left for Gonzaga women this year. We're kind of further along than it almost feels like.
Yeah, so if you're wanting to catch a game, you got to join us in the near future. But similar to what we talked about earlier on in the broadcast, Greg, of every WCC team is gunning for the Zags. The Zags have had a target on their back in this conference for years now. And with your strength of schedule being what it is, or what it isn't, rather, you have to show up night in and night out, especially on your home court. Take care of business, and when you go out on the road, you have to do the same thing. You can't afford to drop anything against opponents in conference.
And then there is San Diego's upcoming schedule. I know that Portland is not as good as they were last year, but Portland-Gonzaga back-to-back, that is still a doozy.
That's a tough stretch for the Toreros, but I think they're up for it. They are a physical, aggressive team. They like to play fast. They like to get in your face, make you uncomfortable. which is something that has been successful against the Zags and Portland as well. So if anybody's going to knock off those two teams, it could be this Torero program.
That was an awfully fun, quick halftime interview that we had with Gonzaga's head coach. You see her there, Lisa Fortier. In case you had gone up to get a drink or go to the bathroom or something, she basically said, we are not being physical enough, and the refs are giving all the calls to San Diego. So I will be interested to see exactly what she has drawn up here at halftime, because we have seen her happier than that at halftime before, I will say.
Yeah, she was frustrated with her team's lack of physicality. I was taught as a player that the benefit of the doubt is going to go towards the aggressor, probably the only situation where that's the case. But look for the Zags to come out and be a lot more physical, set that tone early, because if you let San Diego do it, you're going to be playing a really rough game for the next 20 minutes of play.
Well, there's... Well, that's hard to beat. On the move, Sheffy fouled.
I like the tempo that Sheffy is playing with. Her decision-making when she does get into the paint has to be a little bit better. A little out of control there, but I like the motor that she's playing with. She needs somebody to kind of step up and help her out in terms of scoring, but there she did a great job of pushing in transition. She needs to go off of 2 feet here. You're on balance. You can have a little floater into your pull-up. As soon as you leave your feet, you're putting the ball in the ref's hands to go up against you there.
Strong throws it right off the foot of Neubert. That was heads up. Neubert was great against Gonzaga last time they played. 11 and a double-double. Kaylin Trong now give her 9 points, all of them. I'm just now seeing Shaq off threes. 3 for 4 from downtown for 9 points.
She's doing a great job of just being available from the three-point line.
Liza, nice recovery on the heads-up play, as San Diego just sent on Claire Gallagher for her first run of minutes tonight. Did not play in the first half. Zags will put on Callie Stokes as Kaylin Trong goes off. That was beautiful.
Great job of Kaylee getting her hands in there and convert. They're proving that they can shoot at a good free throw percentage tonight, so you don't want to keep sending them there for easy baskets.
Kylie Horsemeyer. She was electric in the first half. The Casey Neubert fouled. And now we will see the redshirt senior shoot some free throws. Try to improve on her 2 points so far.
That foul as well was on Maxwell. That's her third.
We'll see if they keep her on.
I think part of the frustration, though, is the player, the Torero player that she's guarding is not traditionally a strong three-point shooter, so her help side, she was late. Gonzaga coaching staff unhappy with the decision she made there. It looks like they're going to keep her in, maybe not, as you see Claire O'Connor heading to the scorer's table.
And Neubert hits the free throws. For the first time this afternoon, we'll see Claire O'Connor coming off the bench. Another one of these players who is very clearly going to be a huge part of next year's young team that might be something of a rebuild, not something to think about too much yet, but loved what we have seen out of her in the minutes she's gotten this year. That'll be a push on San Diego. Should be on Claire Gallagher.
Claire O'Connor, tremendous upside. She has great length. She's a good shooter. She works really hard, too. I'm really impressed as a freshman to come in. She's a bit of a gym rat.
Yep.
She's in here all the time. So you love to see that if you're a fan of the program. I know for the Zags coaching staff, they don't like to think of it as a rebuilding, but more a reloading.
Yes.
They really focus on player development. They want their bench players to be ready for that opportunity.
What a sequence. Von Ejim gets fouled. And you're exactly right about Claire O'Connor being a gym rat, Shaq. We usually show up, I don't know, 2 hours, an hour and a half before the game for our broadcast here, and Claire was out on the floor, like, literally the entire time.
Definitely. And I was here even earlier than that because of alumni weekend, and we had some stuff on the itinerary, and Gonzaga had their shoot around this morning, and she stayed even after to get some shots up as well. So she's hungry for it, and so I'm really excited to see where her career goes for this program.
She, Breece Allenbein, Callie Stokes, Peyton Muma, that's going to be a good front court next year. Backcourt, rather. It's going to be a good backcourt. And now Sheffy out top. Coach 48 at halftime said that she's been aggressive and done a good job. She's got 9 points on 3-for-8 shooting. Horsemeyer out to Sheffy. She likes to drive. And finish. One more.
But again, I think the frustration is that they're allowing her to go left off of these ball screens. There wasn't even a ball screen. It was just a quick little jab step to the middle, and she's going to her dominant hand. So it's almost like even on the catch, you need to open up your hips a little bit. And
this was a 10-point game at halftime. Gonzaga has opened it up since then. Like the aggressive shot there by the freshman O'Connor. Second chance.
And stamina, as you see Sheffy able to knock down a three as well.
Yeah, the sophomore from Woodinville, only a sophomore. This is a pretty young team, the San Diego group. She's going to be great by the time she's an upperclassman. I mean, she already is, but she'll be even better. Starting to pull away, and Callie Stokes helping him do it.
Great job with the one more pass. Callie knocking it down. When you watch it back on film, it's funny because you'll see yourself, you know, hands out, face in total disgust and surprise at the ref, and then you watch it back on film and you're like, oh my gosh, I hacked her. Like, there's like how I look so silly out there being like, I didn't touch her at all. And it's like, yeah, she's on the ground. So I think it's just, you know, the moment, the intensity, the physicality that you're trying to play with. So I had a few moments like that, but you got a pretty good ref crew out there today and most days, so they're just out there to keep you safe.
And here is Sheffy. Oh, tripped up by Mott Hybens, and that one was a mistake.
Accidental contact there, but when you make her lose possession like that, it's a tough foul call, but it is the right foul call. She realized it.
Everyone looks okay. Destiny Burton checking back in for the Bulldogs. She was injured at the start of the season. Nice to see her back out there. A lot of the players, her, Breece Allenbein, who went down with temporary injuries, are finally back and ready to go for the long haul.
The more bodies you have available to you, on the bench, especially as you get later into your season.
Well, what a pass. What a play.
What a play. Torero's actually did a great job of making the ball handler, Kaylin Tron, get further and further away from the basket, but she is so comfortable with the ball in her hands. Eyes are up, has great vision. Eliza Hollingsworth rolled hard all the way to the basket. Great find by Tron.
Here's Carr. Tron runs it down. The Zags will run. It's a 2-on-2 and overshot Esther Little just a little bit on the run. Inside a minute to go here in the third quarter.
That was a point of emphasis for this Zag team coming into today, to run under control and to value and maximize each possession. So great job of getting that steal and pushing tempo there. Unfortunately resulted in a turnover.
Waskovich, the true freshman, rejected by Bree Salenbein, her second block of the day. Little on the run over to Bree. Man in her face. Oh, that was a great shot. An inch or two off. Love the aggression, San Diego ball. No shot clock, just game clock, 21 seconds. So who will it be for the Toreros? But either way, 48 hours here in Spokane. So nice to see how many people came out for this one. Limited opportunities left to watch this team at home this year. Coming up on what would be about 30 consecutive home wins. Lucky her, because that was very nearly foul number four on Brenna Maxwell. Instead, she draws the block, but kind of uncomfortably close, Shaq.
Yeah, she had that open lane. I would love to see her go off 2 feet, one, to protect yourself. I always get nervous when people go off of 1 foot here when somebody's sliding under to take that charge. Makes me a bit nervous. That was a great job by Sheffy, great effort. She was just a little bit late, still moving.
But it was 7 points. She had two early fouls, kept her off the floor for most of the second quarter, came on for the third and picked up a third right away.
Yeah, unfortunate for her. Again, a position she probably hasn't found herself in often this season, especially. So look to see if the Zags can get her going in this fourth.
Vaughn Ejim comes back on for the Zags. In terms of scoring, here's what Gonzaga's got going on. Kaylee Trong with 15, Vaughn Ejim with 21. Hollingsworth and Kaylin Trong. This is just an unlucky day for Brenna. She's not playing any more out of control than normal. It's just wrong place, wrong time. And look at the smile, like she knows. Lucky for her, this is not a particularly close game.
As a shooter, I'm sure Maxwell would have wanted that call as well. So they're gonna leave her in here.
They're gonna let her stay on. They're gonna let her shoot. I think she's a little bit rattled. I think she's in her own head.
Yeah, she just gotta settle in a little bit. There's still plenty of fourth quarter. She just gotta be smart.
And she's got 7 points. I think she'd like to get to 10. That's her season average. I think they can get her one more three in the next 8.5 minutes.
She's hunting them always, so she might be able to get a couple good looks.
And here comes Kaylin Trong to bring it across. Kaylee's got 15, Kaylin's got 9. That's 11 points. She'll have a chance at 12. For the team high. Unusual to get that nail in the coffin moment, but something about this building and this team, you know it when you see it.
Yeah, that was great ball movement. Ball never was stagnant. The Toreros were playing catch up that whole possession, and great job by the Zags to find their shooter on the perimeter.
Maxwell, 9 points. 1 for 3 from downtown. When was the last time she hit only 1 3-pointer in a game in this room?
Yeah, definitely. And like we said, a big part of that is when is the last time that she's been in foul trouble significantly early right on in a game. So unfortunately put herself in that position, but they're going to try to get her some looks, run some plays for her as well. And she's a three-point shooter, so she's able to put a lot of points up on the board in a short amount of time.
Ejimon Newbert. Second chance for Vonnie, no. Over the back and sends Newbert to the floor. accidental, but looked not exactly comfortable for the redshirt senior, Casey Newbert. And that'll be on Vani, no surprise.
Bit of frustration as she kept going for that board.
And Maxwell goes to the bench. That's a little surprising. And Riston back off the bench for San Diego. And here's the freshman from Boise, another Northwest gal, Lauren McCall, running the point. Fun opportunity for her to play for a couple minutes here against the Trongs. That'll be on San Diego.
I do think it's very hard for reffing crews to figure out. You see there Kaylee Trong trying to take a charge. She's a bit late. But I do think that Vonnie doesn't get to the free throw line enough because it's just, oh, she's so strong. Oh, she's so athletic. She's doing a great job this year of not getting frustrated and picking up silly fouls as well. But her dominance is obvious.
20-point game. Road game's coming up here.
Yeah, they have a tough road stretch. Going to be on the road, away from the Kennel and all of its fans. And I think it's important for them to remember while they're on the road that everybody is gunning for them. They've had a target on their backs in this conference for quite some time now.
And at the moment, so go ahead.
Sheffy's just having a game of her own. Kind of the only one for this Tuero program.
20
but
points.
She's up to 20. Great showing here for the sophomore in Spokane.
So Von Ejim will finish with a double-double. Oh, man! Veronica Sheffy kind of gave Kaylin Trong a piggyback ride there on the way to the floor.
And I actually think Kaylin Trong did the right thing here. She knew Sheffy was coming behind her. I think if she should go up in the air, that could have been a little bit more
dangerous, yeah.
But she stayed on the ground, and so it just ends up being kind of a funny piggyback ride situation, and everybody's able to walk away from it.
Vani, standing ovation, 25 points, a double-double, 10 boards as well.
The count was getting a little bit low there for Kaylin Trong, so crafty. She throws it off Sheffy's backside, able to reset, get a better baseline out of bounds for this program.
Did Gonzaga just call for a timeout? No, they want to send Claire O'Connor on. Okay.
I think she was calling a timeout, but just for a sub.
Sure.
I think Coach Fortier saw her getting a bit roughed up those last couple of possessions on offense and said, come and take a seat.
Sure. San Diego wants a timeout. 83-64 is our score. All right, so we've been talking, Shaq, about who's going to be our player of the game today. We had a couple of options. It was really just Yvonne Ejim or Kaylee Trong. 9 from the floor.
Yeah, just really efficient, having her feet set. From tip, she was very aggressive, came out confident. She's somebody that can put points up on the board. She's turned into a little bit more of a passer due to her injuries, but it's good to see her coming into her own again as a confident scorer for this team. 21 points, easy player of the game when you're that efficient.
So she finishes with 21. Yvonne Ejim will finish with 25 and a double-double. Boy, this team, man. Sometimes everyone has 10 points. Sometimes a couple folks have 20. You never know what they're going to do. Claire O'Connor had to look at another three. Didn't take it. Salenbein with some space. I clanked that one up a little bit hard. Inside 2 minutes to go. Shaq, what are our feelings about this game? This is a 10-point game at halftime. Ended up being about a 20-point game, which is what it always seems to be in the West Coast Conference.
I think she'll still be a little bit disappointed with how they guarded Sheffy. She was able to get 20 points off here in the Kennel. That's something that you don't want to see. But yeah, they made some great adjustments. They started playing Zag basketball, low turnovers, pushing the pace, running their sets, getting quality looks every time down the floor. Their defense has always been something that they're working on in this.
And there's 5 points for Callie Stokes. Had a big three for the third consecutive game. And we have a look at much of next year's Gonzaga team out on the floor right now for the last couple minutes of this one. Goes down from the freshman. It's tough out there for an 18-year-old.
Yeah, she looks like she's ready to go.
Especially hard against a team like Gonzaga. She's looked pretty good today. Good for her. Inside a minute to play. It's going to be 28 in a row at home for this team. Five to shoot. The freshman, O'Connor, looking for her bucket. Turnaround. So close. That's the kind of shot she practices in the gym, though. We've seen her do it.
You like to do it. Great job by the Zags of just handling business on their home court. I think it's a goal of this program to not drop any games in conference. You don't want to go into March with some stains on your record, so to speak. So they're trying to show up every night and just get the job done, which they were able to do in the second half against the Toreros.
They are still the only team that has not lost yet in the West Coast Conference. They're off to a 3-0 start in the WCC. And everyone is going to be chasing them from here on in, and isn't that always the way? Next home game for the Zags, January 20th, an always fun rivalry game against St. Mary's. We'll see you back here for that one. So for the great Shaniqua Nillis, our producer Stephen Carr, and the rest of our ESPN Plus crew here inside the McCarthy Athletic Center, I'm Greg Talbot saying good night, and we'll see you next time for more Women's College Hoops on ESPN Plus.